What up, y'all? It's Joe Budden here to talk about Prize Picks. Prize Picks is the best place to win real money while watching football. You can get up to 100 times your money.
Prize Picks will give you $50 instantly when you play your first $5 lineup. You don't even need to win to receive the $50 bonus. It's guaranteed. Just download the Prize Picks app and use code Spotify. That's code Spotify on Prize Picks to get $50 instantly when you play a $5 lineup. Prize Picks, run your game.
Must be present in certain states. Visit prizepicks.com for restrictions and details.
This Steve Jones Show podcast is now loading. The Steve Jones Show podcast is presented by Sunbury Motor Company, Purdy Insurance, Brewers Outlet, and NIL Game Changers. Bringing you an in-depth look at Penn State sports and more, this is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. The Steve Jones Show is presented by Brewers Outlet, Sunbury Motor Company, and Purdy Insurance. Now, from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
And today's show being brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors Kia, routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. Ford Kia Hyundai, the best in new inventory. I ended up going with Ford, and wow, it was a great buying experience. Yeah. Like, you want to walk out of there and feel like you really have been treated well and fairly, and that just defines Sunbury Motors. Whether it's the buying experience, the product lines, the financing experience, everything fell into place. Couldn't say enough great things about it. And it's all at Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com. And don't forget about their great service department. You know, a lot of great pre-owned inventory, service department, inspections, routine, difficult, they'll handle it all. Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury. Sunbury Motors, Kia, routes 11 and 15, Hummel's Wharf, online, sunburymotors.com. Thomas Frank Carr on the show today. We're going to have Phil Steele, something came up on a personal nature that Phil, very important that Phil had to deal with, so we will get him back on at a different time. High school football tonight, suit running around the studio, head like on a swivel. Unbelievable. Are they home tonight?
No, they're up at Williamsport.
Oh. Brutal. Means the suit has to travel.
It's actually pretty quiet here today.
Of course, because he's trying to get there now, I'm sure.
Or resting.
Okay, resting from what?
The week just to be prepared I'd ask. For tonight.
Again, resting from what? We're trying to remember what he did this week. All right. Tua Tagovailoa. The concussion. I want to start out. This is a scary deal because it's the third one that we know of. There will be a lot of calls for him to give the game up. I don't know him at all. Don't know the family at all. I just know what either I've heard him when he's talked or when his family has talked. But I've never met him in my life. So what I'm about to say is just going to be a guess on my part. My guess is that despite the calls for him to make the difficult decision to leave the game, that he will do everything he can to come back. That's just my guess. I think that we all know there are a lot of calls for him. Like, well, this is a tough time. He probably ought to get out, which I completely, okay, understand why people would say that. I completely understand why people would say that he needs to seriously consider it. I completely get that. Completely. But at the same time, it's just a gut feeling on my part that he's doing everything he can to work his way back. And I think Mike McDaniel today essentially said that today. When the play that, I will say this, when the play happened, I couldn't believe that he dove. I thought for sure he was going to slide. And I know it's a fourth down play, so he's probably trying to make sure he got it. But when he dove, I was like, ay. And then I saw that DeMar Hamlin hit. Now, this is where I have a problem with people being critical of Al Michaels. You know, that Michaels didn't say right away it's a concussion. Man, that is not your job. Okay? It's not your job to do that. You have to be very cautious when it comes to injuries when you are the broadcaster. Very cautious. Because guess what you aren't? A doctor. You're not a doctor. So I remember I'm watching the replay last night because I did see the game. I'm watching the replay last night. And my first thought was, oh, man, I wonder if he got a concussion. But then I saw the replay, and he gets hit, not helmet to helmet, but by the chest shoulder area, and his neck twisted. I was like, oh, man. I said, well, I said, could be a concussion. It could be a neck injury. You know, not a, you know, obviously not a super serious neck injury, because we know how bad certain neck injuries can be. But he got twisted so much, like, oy. Right? But they didn't put a collar on him. When they didn't put a collar on him, I'm thinking, okay, you know, I said, I'd lean concussion, just as a person sitting there in the living room in the chair watching the game. But if I'm broadcasting the game, I'm sitting in that broadcast chair. I am not speculating it's a concussion, because that's not my job, right, to do that. I tell my broadcasting class all the time, when it comes to injuries, don't guess.
I would even say, you know, in going to the college game last night when they were cramping up, I mean, they did a good job. They didn't even say that when in what were obviously, what I thought were obviously cramps, but you don't know from up in the press box, that they never even called them cramps. So to make a guess on a head or a neck injury would be not great.
All right. Now, when it comes to cramping, say a player cramps up on the field, there's a tip-off as to the fact that it might be a leg cramp. When they start taking the leg and putting it up over somebody's head to stretch them out, okay, that's the standard protocol for stretching out from a cramp. Okay. Right? But you only mentioned that I would mention that that's what they're doing, and normally that's what it's about, but we'll have to find out for sure. And so they waited for Kaylee Hartung to confirm, and she did a great job of confirming it last night, because she had the report within 8 minutes. as the fact it was a concussion. And he said, well, he was rather low-key about what, like, first of all, you're alive. You're not a doctor. And the smart thing to do was like, hey, let's just essentially wait to hear exactly what it is because it's not my job to guess. Okay? And when it comes to something that serious, you don't want to guess wrong. Right? So you have it confirmed for you. And then when it's confirmed for you, then you go from there.
I think a lot of people saw his hands do the arms do the fencing thing at the end and self-diagnosed and expected Al to self-diagnose.
Right. In other words, it's okay for you to sit at home and say that and see that. There's nothing wrong with that. But when you're the person sitting in that chair, and guess what? I mean, it may not, it's not the prime video chair, but I'm sitting in the Penn State Football Network chair. We don't sit there and speculate on injuries. We will describe what happened. We'll describe on the replay what happened. We'll describe the fact that he's up, he's limping, he can't put any pressure on his right leg, you know, something like that, because that's just description. It's not me diagnosing a Jack Ham. We don't diagnose injuries. Doctors and trainers do that. And then we get told later what it is. Okay? We get told later what it is. And how many times has somebody been down on the field? They've come out, and they eventually take them out on a stretcher. A lot of care. And I'll say 9 times out of 10, I said many times these are the ultimate precautions. We'll have to wait to see truly how serious it is. I've said that a bunch of times. And thank goodness, except for Adam Talaferro, which was just horrendous. I think almost every time I've mentioned that on the air, it's turned out it was, quote, not as serious as first feared. With Adam Talaferro, we never knew. We just described the scene. We were on the air for 20 minutes straight during all that. And Wayne Sebastianelli essentially saved his life on the field. But we couldn't see from there. Now, we talked about the play. I've only heard the play once ever. And it was Thanksgiving Day that year. And CBS did a piece at halftime of the Georgia Tech game. And I happened to be watching it. And they used like 5 or 6 clips of Jack and I during the sequence. That's the only time I've ever heard it, because I never wanted to go back and listen to it. And I, you know, I knew it was serious. Okay, just so everybody, when it happened, I knew it was serious, but I didn't know how serious it was till I went down to the locker room after the game. That's when I knew, like, okay, what's going on? Okay, whoa. Okay, so he's in the hospital. Okay, he can't move. You know, this is what, you know, I didn't know that till I got down there, because at that point we didn't, in the network history, we did not have a sideline reporter. So I knew it was serious. And then after the game, I mean, you know, I saw a couple people with some tears, and I saw the look on Joe's face. I remember Tom Venerino being on the phone in the locker room. My bag was in the locker room because I had to put it there before the game. I didn't go over with the team. So I went down to pick it up, and I saw Tommy on the phone. I saw the look on Joe's face. When I saw the look on Joe's face, I'm like, oh, man, this is way worse.
That's how I knew how bad Max Angle was last year when the Salem's Grove training staff came back over on the sidelines. You can just tell by people's reactions when things aren't going great.
Right. You know, and so thus, you know, we never speculated on the air, the gravity of it, because we didn't know. So if you don't know or you're not sure, you don't say it. And You know, I'm sure if I were to ask Al Michaels, I mean, you feel comfortable with how he handled it? He looked at me and goes, of course. And you know what? I completely agree with it. Handled it just right in the air. Okay? Handled it just right. You have to understand the job before you criticize the job. You don't know the job, can't criticize it. And some of these people with criticism, let's face it, you cannot take them seriously. So it's just the way it is. He seems to get picked on a lot, and I think he gets picked on a lot because of age. That's just me. Just a guess. Hey, this is a strange weekend because this ends up being one of the rivalry weekends of the season. And because they're non-conference games, they're taking place now. Washington State's going to Seattle. They're going to play Washington. The game is not going to be at Husky Stadium. It's going to be where the Seahawks play at Lumen Field. Oregon State in Corvallis is hosting Oregon. And West Virginia is playing Pitt at Acrisure Stadium. Those are some of the rivalry games. I mean, Florida Atlantic is playing Florida International. But because of the way conference realignment has happened, these games are happening in week 3 instead of week 12. Interesting.
I was going to say, the backyard brawl is usually, I know the other two are pretty late, but the one backyard brawl I remember being at the Johnstown paper after a playoff game when Pat McAfee missed the field goal.
Go! Oh, shouldn't have brought that up.
Well, he's doing his own show. He can't hear us.
Yeah. True. But yeah, that's
before he was Pat McAfee, I guess, right?
Yeah, and what was it? What, that year where West Virginia was ranked second or something like that?
I think it's the same year, isn't it?
Okay. Well, what happened was I was doing a basketball game at St. Joe's that day, and I got back in time to see the fourth quarter, and I'm like, oh, well, this is interesting. And I think Dave Wonstadt was the coach at Pitt, wasn't he?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I was in Johnstown. I didn't realize how seriously people took that game until I was in Johnstown for it.
Really? Okay.
Yeah. They were all up at the TV, and I was trying to do my game, trying to do my story.
Wow. Okay. We'll take a break this half hour, brought to you by Sunbury Motors, 4th Street in Sunbury, Sunbury Motors Kia, Routes 11 and 15 in Hummel's Wharf, and online at sunburymotors.com and News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Did you know Nationwide is so much more than a great insurance company? They're one of America's largest financial services companies. Like how I'm more than just quarterback Peyton Manning, I'm also meditating Manning. Omaha. For your insurance and financial needs, Nationwide is on your side.
Nationwide Investment Services Corporation, member FINRA, Columbus, Ohio.
Sunbury Motors Ford in the North 4th Street Auto Plaza is having their fall kickoff blitz. Savings of up to $12,416 and financing as low as 0%. Score a great deal on the award-winning 2024 Ford Bronco Sport, and SMC has 18 in stock, priced from as low as $29,965. Sunbury Motors is going to give you a Hail Mary of a deal on over 50 2024 Ford Escapes, priced as low as $27,915. Plus, get 1.9
0.99% financing for 60 months. SMC is the Hall of Fame of Ford F-150s, with 35 available, with discounts of over 12 grand, and they are slashed to the lowest price of the season, starting at only $48,859. Don't let the play clock run out on these awesome deals, as the final drive of savings ends Monday, September 30th. Sunbury Motors is a fifth-generation Ford dealer, proudly owned by the Mertz family for over a century.
Party time, game time, or just fun time. Doesn't matter what time it is, because it's Brewers Outlet time. The Beverage Supermarket has the area's largest beer selection. Imports, microbrews, ciders, and domestics. Pick from over 100 ice-cold 12-packs and dozens of 24-ounce singles. Soda, snacks, hot sauces, fresh roasted peanuts. Make it one-stop party shopping, and don't forget the pickle bar. So whatever you're celebrating or just doing it up, Brewers Outlet, Reagan Street, Sunbury, wants to see you. And thank you for your years of patronage.
Bringing you an in-depth look at Penn State sports and more. This is the Steve Jones Show on News Radio 1070 WKOK. The Steve Jones Show is presented by Purdy Insurance, Brewers Outlet, and Sunbury Motor Company. Now, from the Sunbury Motor Studio, here's Steve Jones.
And this half hour brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Auto, home, light, business, boat, motorcycle, RV. We have a multitude of insurance needs. Purdy Insurance handles them all, and they also do everything they can to save you money while making sure you're fully insured. Go with the pros, the best in the business. Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury. Go to purdyinsurance.com. Someone I had the privilege of working with for a long period of time, and he's just an absolute gem, both on and off the air, and that is Thomas Frank Carr. My friend, welcome back. Great to have you with us.
Steve, you always make me blush. Always glad to be here. Thank you for that kind introduction.
And he's feeling great because the Bills did play well last night, so it's a plus.
Yeah.
I saw the game. You look good.
Yeah, and they like doing things that they need to do to be good this year, including running the football. I'm not used to that. I'm used to Josh Allen having to go superhero, but he did. It was terrible for my fantasy team because I have Josh Allen, but when James Cook looks like that, I don't care. Like that's a recipe for this team to actually be good this year, despite some of the thoughts that they're not going to be. So anyway, you got me started. I could talk all day about that. So, and I know that's not what I'm here for.
Right. But by the way, it should be pointed out, if you have, I'm not a fantasy player, never have been, but quarterbacks are a different ride for you, everybody right now, because only two of them have had 300-yard passing games. So that's it.
Yeah.
Two, which is amazing.
Yeah.
You've done film study, and you do it every week on this team, and breakdowns on this team to this point. So let's start with the defensive side of the ball. In a tale of two halves that saw Connor Bazelak go 13 of 15 in the first half, and to the credit of Bowling Green, they go out and they rack up 21 points in the first half. And then in the second half had 89 yards total and 41 in the last drive. What differences did you see in the film breakdown?
It's a great question. There's a couple of things that happen, but the first thing and the most important thing, James Franklin talked about it, is they did not play well in the first half. So people were wondering coming out of that, is there some sort of template to beat Penn State and to get yards of the Penn State defense? Yes and no. If they play certain coverages and they play them in a certain way that they have so far this season, yeah, everyone knows how to beat man coverage and press man coverage, which is what Bowling Green did, which is they were running a lot of slants, a lot of rub routes, a lot of things in third and short to get conversions, and then just winning in one-on-one situations. But in the second half, the defensive line played better. They woke up, they shut down the running game. I think it was 2.5 yards per carry, which includes quarterback runs in that situation. And I know Connor Bazelak had a designed run that went for about 11 yards. If you look at like the standard running game with the running backs, there was nothing in the second half because specifically Penn State defensive tackles played so much better in the second half. They controlled the defensive line, which is what we expected coming into the game. So when you're not in third and short, you can't use some of those techniques and tactics they used in the first half in order to get those quick passing completions. And so the ball had to stay in the pocket a little bit longer, and then Penn State's defensive line was able to get pressure. So it's all connected, and they also did a couple of things from a schematic perspective of actually disguising coverages and making it a little bit harder on Connor Bazelak. And then, again, those the indecision of holding onto the football caused more opportunities to get to the football for the secondary, leading those big interceptions that ended the game for the Nittany Lions.
The tackling part of it, normally I feel, I don't care what level, the NFL, college, even high school, that right around the start of game three is when I start to feel like I'm seeing across the board in general better tackling. Yet the odd part is that Penn State tackled really well in the West Virginia game. How surprising was it, the tackling in game two?
Yeah. Well, I think that's partly, as Jane Franklin called it, moving parts, because KJ Winston didn't play in the second half. I don't think he was totally healthy going into the game. Just watching him, he is usually an explosive, dynamic player, and he just seemed a little tentative. So that's just my observation of watching him over the years. He's the team's best tackler. And when you lose him, it forces Jalen Reed to go back and play safety, which puts Cam Miller into the slot as the nickel defender. And that was not a recipe for Penn State to have a whole lot of success, because that cascading effect of losing your best tackler, putting your second best run defender away from the football and adding in guys who aren't as big and aren't as strong or as physical was part of the problem. And then Tony Rojas, who's had his own issues tackling, he also left for the first half, came back in the second half, and despite what looked like he couldn't take contact from offensive linemen, still played pretty well. But I think the linebackers and some of the depth players struggled without Kobe King and Tony Rojas on the field, which was the case at the end of the first half, which allowed some of those explosive runs. So they settled down after halftime, but I do think it losing those players had an effect that caused that as much as the team has tackling issues. I think there's a little bit of that, but it's not as dramatic as it might seem based on the fact that you lose a guy like KJ Winston, who I think has missed two tackles in 3 years at Penn State.
Which then flips us to the other side. You've had two games now to look at Drew Aller playing quarterback in this offense of Andy Koltunicki. What are your thoughts on his play?
I love it. It's everything I've wanted to see from Drew Aller. Yes, there are some mistakes. The interception in the end zone was a mistake, a misread coverage, and a great job by Bowling Green of reading that situation and putting the offense in an unexpected situation with a coverage defender dropping out of his assignment to go read the play. That was a really good play by that defensive back. But generally, Aller has been decisive of when to run, when to throw. He's maintained his ability to read a defense, but he's more confident and he's throwing with more conviction, which means he's throwing much farther down the field. I'm actually right now in the middle of writing an article about some of the differences from last year to this year, and the numbers are shocking. So PFF tracks average depth of target, how far down the field you're throwing the football on average. Last season through two games, it was 5.9 yards. This year, it's double that, 12.4 yards down the field. So maybe the accuracy and the completion percentage look different, but the efficiency, the explosiveness, even the on-target passes that aren't being completed. You think about the Trey Wallace play where that ball is on the receiver's frame and it's broken up. Amari Evans, 54 air yards, and he throws it down to the goal line on target, and of course Amari Evans pushes off on that play. And then James Franklin talked about this. I broke this one down in detail at Thomas Frank Carr on Twitter. He had two third down conversions of 9 and 14 yards that were erased by penalties and drops.
Right.
So his decision making, his aggressiveness, his accuracy, for the most part, there's always a couple clunkers with him every once in a while. But overall, I love the way he's playing. This is, and if he continues to play like this, and that's a big caveat because the schedule's obviously going to get more difficult. If he continues to play like this, this is a draftable quarterback. And with his skills, I think that means that's a first-round draft pick as a quarterback, with the massive caveat that he has to do this against Big Ten opponents. But as far as what he's done, it's everything I've wanted to see from him from a confidence and execution standpoint.
It's interesting. On first down against Bowling Green, Penn State had 30 first down plays and gained 313 yards in the game. That's on first down plays. That's not bad. Penn State was 2 of 9 on third down in the game after going 5 for 11 against West Virginia. I know part of it was penalties, as you just played out, that took away two first downs on third down plays. Anything else you're seeing on third down that is of any concern?
I think the average distance has been a little bit inconsistent. You'd love to be, and this goes into some of the conversation about third down efficiencies, I think, and this is just off the top of my head. I haven't looked at these numbers, but I think in that game, the average down and distance was a little bit longer than you'd like. So some of those third downs weren't as easy to convert. Right. You know, talking about that one that was called back to, from Trey Wallace, that was a third and seven.
I'll add to that, of the nine third downs they had, only three were of 4 yards or less. So you may continue.
And one of those, Aller completed by going fully through his progressions and finding Khalil Dinkins on the backside for a critical first down under pressure. These are, you know, the combination of the factors that he's been able to work through so far are why I'm so positive on that. But then you think about the other one. It was the three and out to end the game in the fourth quarter last week. It was 3rd and 7 or something like that. Maybe it was 3rd and 9, and they threw 54 yards down the field to Trey Wallace. So that was a shot play on third down. So that goes into if they had called something different to just try and get the conversion as opposed to we're going to try and end the game here, maybe those numbers look a little bit different. But it speaks to the aggressiveness and the efficiency of the explosive plays in the offense, which you'll take that over 90% completion percentage, which is what he had through two games, but a lack of explosive plays in a meaningful way that consistently sustained throughout the season.
Andy Koltunicki has talked about getting the ball into the hands of his top playmakers. Two of them happen to be Nicholas Singleton and Catron Allen. We know what the running numbers are, but Allen caught a touchdown pass in the victory over West Virginia. Singleton caught one in the victory over Bowling Green. What are your thoughts on what you're seeing of the two running backs in the pass game when needed?
Well, Catron is what Catron is, which is he came to Penn State a professional running back from like a baseline skill set of knowing how to read, knowing how the intuition to run, and having great hands. So it's a continuation for Catron Allen of excellent play. But to me, the development of Nick Singleton into a complete back from all of those facets where he's now closer to the mental player that Catron Allen has been this whole time has been a difference maker. And especially as a receiver, to catch that touchdown pass between two defenders in the end zone, running a vertical route, those are things Nick Singleton would not have done years ago when he stepped on the field as a pretty raw five-star prospect. He's put in so much work. I know you've seen it more than the rest of us, but when we get to go and see practice, I've been watching him over the last couple of years of fighting the football and fighting the football and fighting the football and getting better and better to the point where now he looks like a much more natural pass catcher. I'd say the area they need to still improve is their pass blocking. That has caused some issues from some missed assignments that give free rushers or just kind of lacking some stoutness in the pocket where they haven't kept Aller as clean, but generally that's improved as well. Like, they are complete running backs in every sense of the word, which is why Penn State's having such an explosive start to the season, because the receivers did not play well overall against Bowling Green, and yet you still had Tyler Warren, Catron Allen, Nick Singleton able to generate those explosive plays and prop up the passing game in different ways. So it's a very glowing report on the offense so far, despite what, you know, maybe some of the consternation that game was closer than it should have been, in air quotes. I think Penn State still left maybe 21 points on the field in terms of passing plays that should have been completed to generate more points. That's pretty great when you scored 34, but you feel like there were still a ton of points out there.
What are your thoughts on the offensive line to this point through two games?
You were never going to replace Caden Wallace and Olufashinu one for one in this offense. But I'd say if there's one area that I am a little concerned, it is the tackle play and the offensive line in general. Just example here, there was one play, I believe it was one of the conversions that we've talked about ad nauseum so far in this conversation. It was an eight-man coverage situation, which means there's only three pass rushers, and Drew Shelton gave up a pressure in that situation. Right. That's concerning. So that's an area where they need to continue to develop those offensive tackles. They have the talent. Anthony Donko has been a difference maker in the run game. I think generally the offensive line and the way that this offense helps them from a execution standpoint of making their job a little bit easier from block angles and playing quick and getting to the second level with easier targets to hit. Vega Ioane, Sal Wormley, Anthony Donko, even Nolan Rucci has these high highs as a run blocker where they have difference-making blocks that generate these explosive plays and make it easier on the running backs who have improved as well. So the run game is protecting the pass game a little bit in these situations, and I think Aller's play, believe it or not, coming into this season, we would have said the offensive line has to block well or Aller can't play well, and the inverse is true. He has made up for some of these leaky pass protection situations with great pocket mobility and decisiveness with the football. So that's good in that sense, but you'd like to see some of those things improve from a pass protection standpoint. Generally, I think the interior of the line has been pretty good. So that's good that they have kind of a stout middle that's allowing Aller to maneuver. But yeah, I would say the thing that I would be concerned most about at this point is something we figured coming in, which is that their tackles would not play to the same level they did last year because both those guys were drafted in the top 90 picks of the draft.
Always a pleasure, my friend. It's great to hear from you, and appreciate everything you gave us today.
Awesome, Steve. Don't be a stranger. I always love talking.
Same here. Thanks. Look forward to having you back on. Thomas Frank Carr, fabulous work as always. Film breakdowns are just outstanding. We will come back more in a moment. This half hour brought to you by Purdy Insurance, Market Street in Sunbury, here on News Radio 1070 WKOK.
Hi, this is Season. For over 100 years, the Purdy Insurance Agency has been protecting families and businesses of the greater Susquehanna Valley and beyond. With the experience of our trained and knowledgeable staff, you can rest assured that your needs will be evaluated and met by some of the industry's best representatives. No matter what your insurance needs are, call Purdy Insurance today at 570-286-5855. Visit our website at purdyinsurance.com or check us out on Facebook to see what we can do for you.
Thanks to Thomas Frank Carr for being on the show today. Bob Nightingale next half hour. We'll talk about Major League Baseball. It's great. Aaron Judge got a hit last night. It's great.
It's the longest stretch without a home run in his career. 16 games.
Mm-hmm. Yep. Might be tired. Yeah, not used to playing this many games.
Yeah. The Yankee offense is heavy to carry, too.
Well, Juan Soto did a great job last night. He won it for them against Boston in the 10th. And look, the Yankees are doing enough to win. And the Yankees have been good lately, not great, good. The offense is exponentially reliant on Soto and Judge. It's too much to ask two guys to do it all. They need help up and down the lineup. They're not getting it. Their bullpen, I mean, the closing part of it is a problem. I think some of their starting pitching is very good. No getting around it. The Phillies are a better all-around team. And keep in mind, we talk about Judge. Bryce Harper hasn't homered in, a month?
Yeah.
Yeah, but he's hitting. The difference is he's hitting. Judge isn't really hitting right now. I know the average is still over 300, but he's not, you know, he's having, when he does hit, he's been getting a lot of 1-for-4s and 0-for-5s lately. But Harper's not doing that. But it's a deeper, more balanced lineup. Schwarber, Realmuto, Castellanos. Castellanos is quietly having a really, really good year. And Trey Turner has been terrific since he came back. I mean, Trey Turner has been everything. You know, they signed him to this 11-year deal. And I'm going to go back to a year ago. And a year ago, I said sometimes in the first year, people press. And in the second year, they settle down a bit and play more like the guy that you thought you signed. Turner's played like that. The fans gave him a big lift last year, and he came on strong in the final third of the year. Since coming back from the injury, he's been terrific. Now, Bone isn't out there. I mean, that's a... You know, they need to get him back in the lineup.
It is amazing. Remember, he was the one that they were going to need to replace 2 years ago, and now all of a sudden, you know, he figured it out, and he's kind of a key piece now.
Bone?
Yeah.
Oh, he's become a terrific player, and he's become much better in the field. You know, he's better in the field than I thought he was going to be when I did games when he was at Williamsport.
I was there in Williamsport when his first year when he was picked. I don't think people realized what a large human being he is.
Oh, he's huge. He is massive. Powerfully built. I mean, that was my biggest concern with him, but I didn't feel like he had the flexibility to play third because of his size. To his credit, he's worked on it and it's very good.